The introduction of writing which created the second level of consciousness. The 42 books of Thoth recorded that after the fall, when the Atlanteans got into Egypt and were no longer experiencing full memory, writing was introduced. In fact, it's written right in the Egyptian records that it was Thoth who introduced writing to the world. This one act completed the fall and threw us out of the first level of consciousness and fully into the second. Because it changed the way we access memory, it sealed our fate. This act of learning how to write caused us to grow the top half of our skull from our eyebrows up. The simple act of introducing writing changed many factors in the way we perceive our reality. To get at our memory now, we have to go in and pull out the desired information with a code. We go in with a word or a concept to bring back the memory of whatever it is. In fact, we can't even remember something without having certain eye movements. Our eyes have to move in certain ways to in order for the memories to flow out. The Egyptian memory system was vastly different from the way it was before the fall. Comparing this change of memory to the Osiris saga, the Egyptians had entered the stage where they were in separate pieces, where they were inside their bodies, thinking they were separate from the rest of reality. This feeling of being separate was, of course, destined to change many aspects of how human beings live. The roadblock of polytheism, okay, chromosomes, oh shoot, we're having a verbal malfunction. The roadblock of polytheism, chromosomes, and netters. Now the plot thickens. Things were going well with the stair-step evolution plan. After a while, Upper and Lower Egypt combined into one country under King Menes, and the first dynasty began. But as time went on, a serious problem developed, which, if it had not been solved, would have caused major catastrophes. Okay, I apologize. For us in the 20th century, in fact, we would not have survived as a planet. We wouldn't have had a chance. It seems like a not so important thing, but it was very important for some who watch over this planet. It had to do with the religious belief of the Egyptians. As I said, the Egyptians no longer had full holographic transpersonal memory anymore. So they had to write down what their religion was. This writing is called the 42 Books of Thoth. Donald Beeman, who lives in Boston, is the man who reconstructed this book. There were 42 books with two more books set aside from the main body. 42 plus 2 represents the number of chromosomes of the first level of consciousness. Your chromosomes, as you are about to see, are geometric images and patterns that describe the entire reality, not just your body, but everything in the single atom. Inside this book, you'll see what are called netters. Netters are gods with a small g. This is one of the netters, Anubis. They are mythical human beings with animal heads, and each one represents a different chromosome, a different aspect
and characteristic of life. Netters represents the pathway of how to go from the first to the second level of consciousness. The ascended masters use Osiris' particular genetic coding to help other. Genetic coding and what we're doing a lot now. We've CRISPR Technologies.
They're advancing like super fast right now. They're like creating so much, you know, like editing, gene editing, and patients right now, and they fix someone's like kind of like. Someone had like a syndrome of some kind, and they're like, he's like being, him or her is being slowly, you know, put back together. Their DNA is being fixed. Very interesting. And I'm probably going to make a video soon about Tori Gym, a Japanese company that's going to start regrowing teeth within 6 years. Human beings will be able to regrow their adult teeth if you lose your teeth, so that's a good thing. Okay, but here we go. I digress. So I'm gonna do this reading. Chapter five is very long, so I'm not gonna be able to finish it today too, so we're just gonna read a little bit. Here we go, and I hope you guys enjoy this view and you guys don't see my ugly mug. You guys don't see the ugliness, so I'm hiding behind the camera. Help other people learn how to ascend. In other words, Osiris had lived the experience of ascension, and now the pathway was in his DNA, especially the chromosomes. The genetic keys were then opened to the initiate through the netters, who represented Osiris' chromosomes. But a problem developed from this way of representing their religion, especially as Upper and Lower Egypt again became more separated. Both Lower and Upper Egypt had 42 plus two gods or netters representing these stages, but Upper Egypt had images slightly different from those of Lower Egypt. The images had changed over time when the two countries were separate. When Menes put the two countries together as a single country called Egypt, in order to be politically correct, he adopted all these images. So now they had 84 plus four gods representing the same religious ideas. That was probably a big mistake because it got very confusing. For instance, in one area they would take one of the netters like Anubis and say, "This is God," with a big G. Another area would say, "Isis is God." And another area would claim Shikmet to be their god. So then there were 88 different ideas of God in the country. They would say, "My God is the God, and your gods are wrong." It became very separated and occult. And after a while, no one had any idea that there really was only one God. They didn't understand what the Tat Brotherhood was trying to tell them. From our American point of view, this would be like a chromosome breakage. It was a mutation, and it was not correct. Even with all the help from the Tat Brotherhood, they just couldn't get it right, and it got worse and worse. All the evidence I've seen indicates that the Christian religion came directly out of the Egyptian religion. If you study both of them, they're parallel in every single way except for the Egyptians' understanding of God. The Christian religion came back later and totally disconnected the Egyptian religion. Even though Egypt is the probable source of the origins of Christianity, the Christians saw the Egyptians as being a cult. And they were, but it was because their religious belief had become corrupted, with the clear exception of 17 and a half years during the 18th dynasty, the rescue of human consciousness. Akhenaten's life.
a brilliant flash of light. For a very short period of 17 years and a half, a brilliant flash of light appeared, then disappeared again. And that brilliant flash of white light is what saved our spiritual lives. It began in approximately 1500 BC, when the worshipping and arguing over so many gods was prevalent. The ascended masters finally decided that something must be done. Finally, they chose a plan. Thoth told me the following story. As the first step, they decided to bring in an actual Christ conscience, being in an actual Christ conscience body, so he could put back into the Akashic records the memory of what Christ consciousness was all about. It had been lost in the fall. The Christ consciousness body would be much taller than those on the planet at the time. This would be an example for the Earth people to see. That was the first part of the plan. It was a very bold step, and they did it. The Ascended Masters had decided that the Christ consciousness person should become king of Egypt. In order to do this, they had to break all the rules, and I mean all of them. What they did was approach the king of the period, Amenhotep II, and ask him for a favor. Thoth simply walked into the room physically, went right up to him and said, "Look, I'm Thoth," which I'm sure was difficult for the king to believe. By the time, the Egyptians probably thought that all those netters in their stories were mythical, yet there's a real person standing there who was one of the netters. Thoth said, "We have a serious problem here in Egypt, and I need your help." And there is a problem in Egypt right now. There's a problem all over the world. And all these people are just fighting each other. It's like deja vu, going over and over again. Okay, but here we go. Thoth somehow got Imhotep II to do something that no Egyptian king would ever do. Imhotep's son was about to become king, and Thoth said, "I want your son to not become king. I want to put an outside lineage onto the Egyptian throne." Imhotep II agreed to it. It must have been a pretty profound experience. I don't know what Thoth did. He probably came in glowing or levitating or something like that. But he did something to convince the king that it was necessary. Once they received the king's permission, they had to actually create the living body, which was not easy. Creating the bodies of Akhenaten, then Nefertiti. So, how did they do this? They went to A and Tia, who were very, very old. No matter how you look at it, and said, "We would like you to have a baby." They had to go to someone who was immortal to get the immortal genes, because they have a different chromosome count, 46 plus 42 instead of 44 plus 42. I'm going to pause right here. So I'm thinking if CRISPR knows all this stuff, of which I'm sure they do, then they're probably trying to hack they're basically DNA hacking. So they're looking for the immortal gene. They could be looking for the immortal gene, CRISPR. I mean, well, basically that's the whole point of like living longer, humans, longevity, all this stuff, you know, on Earth, living longer, because a lot of people are afraid of the afterlife and maybe these evil spirits on Earth like are afraid, you know, they're gonna pay the consequences eventually one day. But here I go, let's go. Maybe they could activate like the giant, I mean, yeah, obviously the giant DNA, the Nephilim DNA, well, that's the same, and who knows what other kind of DNA we have inside of us, all the other crazy stuff. But here we go.
So that little baby grew up and became king. He became Imhotep the Third. So, oh shit. There you go. So that little baby grew up and became the king. He became Imhotep the Third, who then mated. I am not sure if it was physically or interdimensionally, and I don't know who it was, but he would almost have had to mate with someone who had the higher chromosome levels. Anyway, their baby boy became known as Imhotep the Sixth, and that baby was the one they had special plans for. That baby, Imhotep the Sixth, has a more popular name, which you know as Akhenaten. Meanwhile, Antia waited a generation and then had another baby. That baby was a little girl whose name was Nefertiti. Nefertiti grew up with Akhenaten, and then they married. They were really brother and sister because they had the same bloodline. The Osiris story is similar. Brother and sister marrying and becoming a new possibility in life. So these two people grew up and became the king and queen of Egypt. Yeah, and obviously people don't do that today. I mean, not for kingdoms. I mean, who knows? Maybe like the queen over there in England, maybe they're like inbreeds, I'm thinking, or you know, people say they're all like family members, like cousins of cousins, and these people control the world. So who freaking knows? But here we go. I'm gonna read a little bit more. The new rulership and the one god. For a while, Imhotep III and his son Akhenaten ruled the country together, two kings at the same time, again breaking the rules. Meanwhile, they built a brand new city called Til El Amarna in the exact center of Egypt. We still don't know how they got it in the exact center. Akhenaten put a stone there that says, "This is the center of the country." Today, we could not have done it better from a satellite. It makes you wonder who these people were who could locate right down to the square inch, the center of a country hundreds of miles. It's pretty amazing. They built an entire city out of white stones. It was beautiful. It was space age. Akhenaten and his father ruled the country simultaneously from two places for a while, from Tabiz and from Til El Amarna. The father resigned the throne while he was still alive, which again breaks the rules, and gave the country to Akhenaten, who then became the first pharaoh of Egypt. There were no pharaohs before Akhenaten, only kings. Pharaoh means that which you will become. In other words, they were showing the people what they would literally become in the future. Akhenaten, Nefertiti, and their children were not exactly human. This tall figure, 5'7", is Akhenaten. I'm going to talk about this picture for a moment. Akhenaten's main purpose was to break up all the cult religions and bring the country back to a single religion where they believed that there was simply one God. At that time, all the people were worshiping statues, so they were used to believing in things. Akhenaten had to give them something to see, to believe in. So he gave them the image of the sun as God, because this image was something they couldn't stick on their altars again. I'm going to show this briefly, but I don't want to get the copyrightization. The rays of the sun. There was another reason he gave them the image of the sun. He told them that the breath of life, the prana field, came from the sun. This is true in terms of third dimensional thinking. Though prana is really anywhere and everywhere, there are infinite amounts of it at any point. Since prana also comes from the sun, this image shows the sun rays coming down, and on two of the rays are little akins, which the rays are holding up to the nose, to the breath, showing that eternal life is through the breath. In this same picture, you also see the lotus, the national flower of Atlantis. It was the Nakals who brought the lotus to India. The Nakals are written about in Indian Sanskrit, written and are talked about even in modern times. They came long before Buddha and were there during Buddha's time. In Egypt, the lotus flower represents Atlantis, and in this picture you see them out of the vases. Everyone knew that Atlantis was dead, but they were still paying homage to it by having the lotus out of the vase. Figure 5-8 is the original wall carving. Notice that Akhenaten, the main figure, has a long skinny neck, skinny hands, a high waist, wide thighs, and skinny legs. The unusual Egyptian explanation is that he had a disease and was deformed, of course. So was Nefertiti and all of their daughters. Evidently, they all had the same disease. I believe something very different. The reign of truth, which depicts a different genetic. So, the lotus is has a psychedelic property, and they're cultivating it right now. I just seen a video about it, because everything like pops up, you know, when you do hashtags and all this stuff. But so it popped up, and I took a look at it, and yeah, it's like kind of like datura, like the datura tea, like, and yeah, it's like, it has a psychedelic effect. I kind of think it's like DMT. Have you guys ever tried DMT? Let me know your guys' experience. I tried DMT. I did probably DMT like 60-something times. I have had a lot of visual experiences on DMT. So I wonder if it's like that. Like, kind of like that. Kind of like the, maybe the ayahuasca. Probably like the ayahuasca, I'm thinking. So they say it could be the actual plant. It has the same properties. Yeah, it was in Egypt. Yeah, there we go. It was in Egypt. They're cultivating it. Like, it grows like an aquatic, like an aquatic pond. And they're cultivating it right now. And because they wanted to, okay, they did a autopsy on an ancient Egyptian mummy dancer. And she basically had like the plant, the psychedelic property inside of her, and they compared it to the genetic makeup of the plant for our time, and they're 100% like a match, like 99.9% match. So I want to get my hands on that. I want to experience that, the lotus psychedelic. That would be amazing. If you guys would do the lotus psychedelic trip, what do you guys do it? Let me know. What do you guys think? Okay, here we go. I'm going to read a little bit more, like 8 more minutes, and then I'm going to call it. So I'm going to show you the picture of the fetish. Again, they got the elongated skulls, you know, Cusco. You guys see them. And she's like a giant. Look at that. She's like super tall. The reign of truth, which depicts a different genetic. And besides making the religious monotheistic. Okay, excuse my reading. You guys know I'm not the best, but let's rewind. Besides making the religious monotheistic again, Akhenaten also said, in this new religion, we're not going to have any more lying. no more untruthfulness, and we're going to change our art so that it reflects the total truth. So during the 18th dynasty, never before nor after, there was a total unique art form. The artists were instructed to sculpt or paint things just as their eyes saw it, like a photograph. So began an art that looked realistic instead of stylized, as it had been before. You see ducks that look like ducks, just like we see in modern art. This is important to remember when you're looking at art of the 18th dynasty, because that means that whatever you see is exactly what the artist saw. They were not allowed to lie. Okay.
Quack, quack.
So there's ducks here too. I don't know if you guys seen them, but this issue about truth was taken so much and extreme that they were not even allowed to wear clothes, because wearing clothes was hiding, and that was a form of lying. No one was allowed to wear clothes during the 18th dynasty except for ceremonial and other special purposes. These netter's name is Mot. That's a feather on top of her head. She became one of the most important netters in this new religion because of her name, which translates as truth or truthfulness. She was the important issue in everything. Everything was to be absolutely truthful, and there were to be no distortions, no lies, so that everything could get back into focus. This was an important part of Akhenaten's teachings. Oh. This is the statue of Akhenaten in the Cairo Museum. Akhenaten was 14 feet and a half feet tall, not counting his headdresses. When I stood next to this, the top of my head came to the widest part of his hips. Nefertiti was 10 feet something. She was actually small for her race. The daughters were also very tall. This is according to Thoth. Hard evidence of this has recently come into official hands, and they don't know what to think about it. They found two caskets in Tal-e Amarna, Akhenaten City. One of the caskets had the flower of life etched directly over the head of the mummy inside, and the second casket held the bones of a 7-year-old boy, but he was 8 feet tall. That casket is sitting in the basement of Cairo Museum at this moment. At least it probably is. It's the only real proof so far of what these bodies look like. From Thoth's teachings, this statue of Akhenaten is actually what he looked like, just as if you took a photograph of him. This is a bust of Nefertiti that was found in Tal-e Amarna. There is almost nothing left of that city. At one point, the city was dismantled brick by brick and spread all over the world. The Egyptians did not want you to know what Akhenaten and Nefertiti had ever lived. The only reason we do know is because they had buried some things in rooms deep underneath the ground that earlier people didn't find. This bust was found there. Many people think of Nefertiti as a very beautiful woman, but they don't realize that she was extremely tall and that her body was very unusual in certain ways. All right, I'm gonna show y'all. I've never been there, but like, if I ever go, I would like to go. If I ever go, I would like to go. Teleport. Okay. Figure 5 to 13 is a little-known statue of Nefertiti found in the same room as the bust. She's not wearing clothes because they didn't believe in that at the time. She had a huge head, large ears, and a long skinny neck and a high waist. She also has a kind of bulging tummy, and if you could see the rest of her, she has skinny legs and wide thighs.
Does she look like an alien? I'm not an alien. I'm not from outer mind power.
All right, guys. So I'm going to end it there. Thank you, guys. Ladies. Namaste. That means hi, huh? Right? And Indian. And Indian. And Indian. I have some Indian followers. So thank you, India, for watching. And
get this book. And check out my art.
So what y'all think? You think they were 15 to 16 feet tall? Do you guys think CRISPR's on the verge of creating immortals? And yeah, I also read too a little bit that the brain, when we're sleeping, our mind predicts the future ourselves. And I mean, I didn't need someone to tell me that, but I mean, it says it in the Bible, our dreams tell the future and all this stuff. But so gotta focus more on seeing the future. So I'm thinking people are, they're gonna develop technologies to predict the future, like Minority Report and all that stuff. Maybe they'll make a synthetic brain, a super brain, which is like the computer, always quantum, huh? Maybe that's what they have. Quantum computer prediction. Destroy the humans. But anyways, yeah, I'm just messing around. I don't want you guys to like get all offended or whatever. You guys can get offended actually, but I just appreciate y'all tuning in, watching, whoever's watching. Let me know if you guys want me to read a book, any book. And yeah, I'm gonna make a lot of mistakes reading, so it's not like a perfect reading, like edited and all this. So it's like raw. So yeah, what y'all think? Have a wonderful day. And remember your ancient past.